A neutron star is a very peculiar astrophysical object.
A neutron star can be pictured as a giant atomic nucleus.
Neutron stars are born after supernova explosions, so they're basically what's left after a star dies.
One typical neutron star has the same mass as our sun, but the radius is about 10 kilometers. So it's basically taking all the mass of the sun and squeeze it in a region that is actually the same size of the city.
So it really wants to collapse under its own weight. But as it collapses, the neutrons inside, so all the particles essentially get packed really tightly together.
So this is a very dense, usually highly rotating, because in this process it gets a lot of spin, and highly magnetic star. It's one of the biggest magnets we know in the universe.
It is exotic matter. It can be the quark gluon plasma. It can be other forms of matter for which there exist many hypotheses.
A single neutron star alone is a very fascinating object. Now, just imagine two in a binary system, which for millions of years is made of these two stars, which orbit around each other. Up until one point, that is up until gravitational forces are so strong that the system has to fuse, producing possibly a black hole. Because neutron stars are made of matter, although very dense, when they merge, they will produce radiation. And this is radiation that we can see with telescope. Why it is interesting and important to study binary neutron stars is that we believe that in this fusion process, some of the matter is lost, is ejected, and is polluting the interstellar medium, producing heavy elements. Elements like gold and platinum, we believe, are produced exactly in this manner.
Basically, we do not know yet how matter behaves in the core of a neutron star. And this is one of the topics, of the main topics of NEUCOM star, to understand what is the internal composition of these particular stars. NEUCOM star is a network composed of different nodes, so we have different countries participating to the network, and each node has a different skill.
The idea was to study neutron stars, so these very compact objects, by merging the expertise of different community of people working on nuclear physics, people working in gravitational physics, and people more on the astrophysics sites, either observers or theoretical astrophysicists.
Cost actions improve research because they allow for many opportunities to network and for different groups of people that would traditionally work in different aspects of certain problems and never talk to each other to actually get together and meet. They allow to actually start a conversation and get to speak a common language and develop links that then allow for actual research to be carried out in these institutions.
I was at the origin of this action, and I could see how it was created at the end of '90s, in the beginning of 2000. And we wanted to create an initiative to do research together and to strengthen this field of research in Europe, and it was a success.
COST is organizing networks that put together scientists from different fields that are looking at the same problem.
Essentially giving us a set of tools. So I would say that COST is a toolbox that allows cooperation between scientists in different disciplines and different countries in Europe.
You are able to go into more difficult problems, come into solutions that are more realistic.
This field has underwent a revolution in which it would be very important to improve and boost collaborations, and in particular share expertise, different expertise. Putting them together and making them collaborate more is crucial to advance. So this would play a major role, I think, in the future.
We exchanged very frequently young people, postdoc and PhD students among different groups to collaborate. So they were basically our links. This has been really very fruitful.
Those people who benefit most are our young scientists, the next generation, because they grow up already now in an environment where they have direct access to formerly separated field of research. And these atmospheres at the schools are very important to grow the new generation of now interdisciplinary trained young scientists.
To have a gender balance in all the activities that we do, an age balance, seniority balance, country balance, and this helps in general, not only from a scientific point of view, but also from a society point of view.
Collaboration with other scientists was fundamental. For example, the most important idea that we followed during my PhD just came from one of those collaborations.
When I was a PhD student, I got involved in ComStar and I got to meet a nuclear physicist. Then within your ComStar, I actually started working with nuclear physicists, and my research interest became broader within UCOMSTAR, and my scientific career really got a boost from thanks to UCOMSTAR. And right now I am involved in Pharos, which is an extension of UCOMSTAR. And so UCOMSTAR was an important step in my career and provided many opportunities, which I don't think I would have had otherwise.
There is not really a single person who benefits from collaborations like these, because it's kind of an open interaction. If you're a bachelor student, you're doing your PhD, you're a postdoc, or even if you're a professor, you interact with people and they tell you things, they share their ideas, they share their thinking, which you were previously not exposed to.
One of the goals of this type of initiatives is also to try to get the students involved in the research that is done in their own departments. They do this through research scholarships for students of doing their undergraduate and master's degrees. So I was lucky to be part of these type of initiatives, and which is not only good because of the intellectual the development, but also because it grants the students some financial stability.
The research today is not the research of an individual person, but it's more like a big organism. So everyone makes a little part in order to complete the big puzzle.
We were always here as a European community working on neutron star physics. But we were just individual researchers most of the time. Of course, as giving us the opportunity to create a network to put, let's say, the European nuclear physics community in the map of the world. I mean, thanks to COS, we have created something from that is well recognized now in the field.
I think humanity always wants to know more about where we are living, right, and what we find in the universe. And this is a curiosity, let's say. But also, from another point of view, trying to reach the boundaries also makes you to go beyond and learn to do new things. And these new things always will have an impact in the economy and the society, maybe medium term, maybe long term, but always have an impact.